want to kind of like understand and let them know, well, I was a sinner once and I carried stuff, and God can save me and save you too.
Mm-hmm. That's good. All right. That's a good explanation. That would be excellent. Okay, now, what would you say concerning God wants us to be filled with the Holy Ghost? Just don't have to do a whole lot on it, but if you had to address that issue, what would you say to the Lord?
I would say spend more time with the Lord and pray more and more every day, like 2 or 3 times a day, whatever, and gradually work your way up to praying in the Spirit. And the Holy Spirit naturally gets in you, not get saved and everything. And if you just seek the Lord and stuff and ask Him, He will fill you with the Holy Spirit.
Right.
So that's basically it, just seeking the ways of His ways.
That's good. Okay, now why is the Holy Spirit so important to receive? What does the Holy Spirit do? You know, the Holy Spirit goes a little further than just being saved, is that right?
Yeah, it guides us, comforts us. It just helps us do things. When Jesus left, He said, I'm a send back a comforter, and He can just help you with everything. So the Holy Spirit is a big part of keeping us and guiding us and leading us and, you know, and helping us build up spiritually, you know, helping people and that love and everything. The Holy Spirit works again.
The Holy Spirit, that's very good. The Holy Spirit is designed to take Jesus' place. Now, what was Jesus terms of being with His disciples, those 3.5 years, what was Jesus to them? What did He, how did Jesus the example, or how, what role did He play in terms of His disciples for that 3.5 years? Anybody?
He was a teacher, right?
Or he's a teacher, that's good. What else? Down, and when you're discouraged or distressed, you pray in the Holy Ghost. the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit takes the place of Jesus down here and there. And whatever Jesus would do if he were here in person, that's the very role the Holy Spirit plays. The Holy Spirit is the official representative of the Godhead down on earth. Where is Jesus now?
In the right of the Father.
Right of the Father. Where is God at? The Holy, you know, God the Father. Where is he? Okay, he's in the heaven. Upper heaven. In the very heaven. That's good. The upper heaven is right. I was trying to explain to my little boys the three heavens. I don't know what they knew what I talked about, though, but Justin was all first heavens, the domain where wicked spirit, demonic forces usually prevail. And the second heavens is the realm where Satan's main operation occurs. You know, the high-ranking demons, the principalities and powers, and the rulers of darkness, that's the realm where they operate. And they send their orders on down to the lower parties, you know, demonic forces. Them to carry out, just like that man was out here killing people about 3 weeks ago.
Yeah,
that was bad. You know what comes on people make them want to do stuff like that? It's these demons that's what preying on people in the lower heavens. Mm-hmm. That's what it does, George. But that's deep. But in the third heavens, of course, that's where God dwells. Heavenly power structure, the angels, and all of that, which governs the universe. That's what that command. Okay, I'm going to go further, okay? Brother George, okay.
Okay. When you was talking about each level,
power structure down in hell.
Mm-hmm.
He says, hell is, it's down in. So Satan operates in hell, but he does not. The Bible says he's the prince of the power of the air.
Mm-hmm.
And the second heaven, that realm, the realm of the celestial beings, and the stars, the moon, and all of that. That's the realm where Satan does his operation from. So that's good. I never thought about it. You got to go to hell. Get through hell. Got to go through hell to get to heaven.
Mm-hmm.
All right. How do you think about that?
The way it sounds, when we go to prayer and stuff.
Okay.
You say that one word, walk through a shadow of death,
right.
Feel no evil.
Right.
Okay, you walk through there, they're telling you you're going straight to hell first,
right.
Then you're going to heaven.
All right.
But you got to go walk through there. And it's dark.
That's good. Okay.
See? That's why you bring the light.
Okay, so that's good. That was a revelation. Okay, how important it is for people to be built up spiritually? Because that's one of the main things that God is interested in. How important it is for people to be built up spiritually? The lesson, it's in the lesson, but also you can answer that from just the top of your head.
It's very important. You have to be built up spiritually so you can grow spiritually, because you can be in the baby stage, the college stage, the youth stage, and you get quite a ways to go.
Right.
You have to learn a whole lot.
Right.
And you always learn, going to another level.
That's good. Okay. Anybody else?
Situation comes out, like you're on the road, and you say, Jesus, well,
animals. A dog is known by his what?
Heart.
A bird is known by his what?
Chirp.
Okay. Then what else we can say? Cow is known by what? You can tell by the sound that comes out what kind of what animal. By man, you can tell what he's all about by the words that's coming out of his mouth. You better watch your words. Okay, what about this? To maintain fellowship, a person has to what? Grow spiritually. Because if you don't grow spiritually, more than likely you're going to be in and out of what? Fellowship. Right? And what about being able to help others and to minister to others? The degree that you will be able to win souls or to get people filled with the Holy Spirit or to help people to stay on track, to encourage them, to build them up, and to give them advice, you know, whatever, depends on what? Your level of what? Spiritual growth. So a lot of things hinge on growing up spiritually, because if you don't grow and stay in the babyhood stage, then you're not going to be able to carry out God in terms of Jesus said that go ye therefore and what? Teach all nations, baptizing them in the what? Name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the what? Holy Ghost. Teaching them to observe what? All things. So Jesus wants his message duplicated to us. He wants the message that we are to take the word. He wants that duplicated. Amen. He taught it, then we're supposed to what? Teach the same thing that he taught. Okay. Okay, now of the various classes of beings interested in the laws, which class seemed to be the least interested? You know, I hope y'all read your scriptures, that God is interested in the laws. There are scriptures that show, anybody can relate a scripture that shows how God is interested. Right? What scripture in the Bible show beyond a shadow of a doubt that God is definitely interested in the laws? Okay, John 3:16 probably is the most popular. You don't have to quote it, but that shows the heart of God towards the law. What about Jesus? What scripture text shows that Jesus is definitely concerned about the laws?
Redemptive
Okay. Let me ask you this. Angels, how are angels, how do they express their interest in us today? Angels. All right, angels rejoice when what? Sinners come. Somebody else, angels do what else?
The ministering spirits, also.
All right, ministering spirits. How many ever experienced the ministry of an angel?
I have heard stories, yes.
Okay.
Like one gentleman that I knew, he was going to a store, and this female came up to him. This person came up and said, "Don't go in there right now." He didn't go in, and the place got robbed, and somebody got shot.
Oh.
And he knew when he turned around and say something to the person, they had disappeared, they vanished.
Wow.
Just like that.
Anybody else heard of any other strange things like that? Anybody ever heard of people getting picked up on the road?
And vanishing inside cars?
Yeah, I've heard of that.
Yeah.
Okay, many times they gave a prophetic word before they vanished.
Right.
Minister to us without, you know, picking up somebody like that or appearing, telling us don't go into the store and all that. How else do those angels minister to us?
Right. scripture just as good as any preacher.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Angels can.
Of course, it's distorted.
Right. All right. So they are deceived if they can deceive, you know, the angels that the money, you know, the money of origin, they can really deceive people.
I can see them too, and they're scary looking like. Talk to them in the morning. I know you're going to pay your partner on Friday, so in the morning you go back to there I would have been just going all off bad. And then we were kind of in a bind for our rent, and so I went to this place to get assistance and stuff, and they usually only do like $50 on your rent or something like that. But once I started talking to the lady, explaining her my situation, my husband's situation, such and such, but your situation is very good. She said, we will get more than usual, so they paid like half our rent, so that was that too. So he was just working on our behalf, you know?
The only group that does not seem to be interested in the laws? Okay, would it be sinners here on earth or saints here on earth? Which group would it be? People that are not interested in the only ones that's not interested, would it be sinners or would it be saints? All right, now we know sinners are not that interested.
It could be both.
It could be both. That's right. In what respect?
In what respect? Okay, the sinners, they already know what they're doing. Okay, right. They are very much content doing what they're doing.
Right.
The saint is because they could be carnal.
Yeah.
They could be focused upon themselves only.
Mm-hmm.
They own this end razor blade. They're trying to live in this world and that world at the same time. And that's the reason why I was taking both.
Okay, very good. Very good.
You can't be lukewarm.
So what now?
You can't be lukewarm.
Okay, right. Okay. That's good.
God said his G at his mouth.
Now, y'all mentioned a few Sundays ago that on a scale from 0 to 10, where would he rank? Somewhere between 0 and 10.
I said 6.
Okay.
I'd go lower.
Wow. You would?
I would go lower.
I'm inclined to go lower, too.
Okay, the reason why I say that is because it is not a corporate thing. It becomes an individual thing.
Right.
Well, Sister A might be 100% devout. Sister D might be. I'm just here because my grandparents went here, my father went here, so it becomes more of a traditional thing.
Right.
A Pharisee viewpoint.
That's good. You know why? Because in a congregation of 100, about how many you think would really be concerned about the laws? Because people are so busy, they're involved in their chores, their routine, their responsibilities, and they work hard, and when they come in, they don't have time to really give the word first place in their lives, pray, and even come to church, you know, because it's so washed out. So in a congregation of 100, you might have people, maybe one out of every 10 that do what, you know, come close to doing what they're supposed to be doing. And if you got 90, that's not, or if you got half of them that's falling somewhere in the middle, then your percentage is still going to be what? Real low?
Yeah.
Real low. Okay, so that's good. All right, so, okay, now what illustration did I give the man that, that chaplain that was about to perform the last rites over a person that was condemned to hang, to be hanged on that gallows? Anybody remember that little story?
Mm-hmm.
It's in the lesson.
That he said that when he was up on the cross, he said that if he could, he would be willing to. When he was dying, he said if he were a Christian and knew the whole destiny of sinners, after they died, he would be willing to crawl from the west coast to the east coast on his knees, on glass, to save one sinner from a place of torment like that, like was described to him.
Okay, what she's reading is in the lesson. You don't have a separate manual there, read it from. So it's all in the lesson. That was a story of a chaplain. You know, just like a preacher that's preaching and just going through the act is a perfunctory type thing. You know, sometimes preachers have preached things maybe 500 times. You don't have to really have no compassion for people because you've already learned it. You don't really have to depend on the Holy Spirit to what? To lead and to guide and to put some feelings and some, you know, some compassion in it because they already know it. So a lot of times we do things through rote. Is that right? Through rote. Just like actors.
Yeah, it's on natural current.
Yeah, right. So that's the way this preacher was carrying out his last rite. This person had committed some terrible crime, and they had condemned him to die on the gallows by hanging him. And his responsibility was to read the last rites, you know, to say words to him, that would be, you know, the last words ministered to his soul, or to, I guess, when people are condemned to die, the power of life and death, I guess, to have life or death lies in the hands of the minister to a great extent. If he preached something half-heartedly, the chances are faith won't be what?
Sung.
That's right. Seats won't be sung, and the person won't respond, and they won't give their life to the Lord. But if they are real compassionate, concerned, I believe something can be said just before people are executed or die. I believe that they can, what, reach out, just like the man on the cross.
Yeah. With Jesus.
Jesus, yeah. Right. What did he say? He said, right, so Jesus had talked something favorably to him, shared with him, and the man was able to what? To grab hold to the word and what? Save his soul.
Mm-hmm.
But this preacher was just really, what? He was just really stunned, and he was a preacher that, we call it, he was heartless, he was cold, he was nonchalant, and but that criminal, he caught it. He said, man, if I were a preacher and I was ministering to somebody who was about to what, die and go to hell, fall down in this horrible pit, he said, I would be willing to get on my knees and do what? Crawl all the way from the west coast to the east coast on glass to save one sinner. How many believers would be willing to pay that price? How many believers would be able to make, to go to any extent to save one sinner from hell? It's not that many. Not that many. Just said, well, let him go into hell. He may show come to church. He should have got himself filled right with God. It's too late now, too bad for him. He had a chance. That's kind of cold, right? Catalyst. So God doesn't want us to be that way. Amen. But unfortunately, you know, sometimes people are. All right, the last question I'm going to do is, I want y'all to be ready for chapter 3 next time. I'm going to let Brother Smith, Sister Noah, Sister Pearl, y'all help me out next week. Y'all got to study real close. Real close. Y'all gonna have to do more than answer the question. You're gonna have to elaborate on it. And I'm not gonna tell you which one I'm gonna ask you to do. So you gotta do them all.
Lesson 3?
Yeah, well next week it will be lesson 3. But I'm gonna do the last one on lesson 2 on page 18 right now. What seems to be the main message we learned from Philippians 2, 19 through 21? Philippians 2, 19, 21. Okay, I'm gonna read those because 7 things we see from the Philippians 2, 19 through 21. Your primary responsibility as the Lord's ambassador is to promote his interest above your own goals, regardless of your circumstances. Okay, now that Philippians 2, 19 through 21 passage dealt with what? Okay, now Paul was writing to the church at Philippi, and what was Paul saying basically in that passage concerning the leaders and the ministers in that particular church? Basically, he was saying that he didn't have anybody. He was sending them, what, Timothy? Because he had, what, looked around and tried to
imagine. He didn't see anybody because there was faith that could
right.
do it. Yeah, that could carry out.
Right,
carry
he didn't,
out.
Right. Right, he didn't see anybody that had the same mindset that Timothy had. Timothy had a real desire to what? To minister and to fulfill the needs of the saints. And it's just the same way in the church. And sometimes it's very hard find somebody to leave in charge that would really care for the well-being of people that's going to come to that prayer meeting the church service unto that particular activity. It's kind of difficult to find people that have the same mindset that the pastor has, if the pastor has a good mindset. But Paul did say that Timothy did have, he said there ain't nobody like Timothy that genuinely have an interest in the what? Care and the well-being of the saints. So he's the one that I'm going to what? He said all of the others are not concerned about the well-being of the what? Church, the saints. They're concerned only about what?
Themselves.
Mm-hmm. Amen. So you don't want to fall in that category.
It's just definitely a lot of people put themselves before other people's interests.
You know? That is so true. You gotta be a good preacher. You're gonna mm-hmm. tell the story next week and be you yeah. a little bit more rope.
Do my best.
Okay. Your primary interest is to promote the interest of what? The Lord's interest rather than your own personal interest. That's your primary. And that is supposed to come before your own goals and interests and involvement and responsibilities. All right, now, before your responsibilities, before your own goals, before your own circumstances, we are to promote whose interest?
The Lord.
The Lord's interest, because we are his ambassadors, is that right? We are bought with the price. We are not to what? We are here to glorify God. He paid the price, he laid down his life, and he's the one that what delivered us from the power of darkness. So we are to glorify. Our prime responsibility is to glorify God in our bodies and in our spirits, which what belongs to him. Amen. You know, sometimes people ask, what right does God have to tell me what to do? I think I read that little story to you. Anybody remember reading that little story that I read?
About the sailboat.
About the sailboat, right? The little boy lost the sailboat, and it ended up way out somewhere.
Yeah.
And somebody found it and took it to the pawn shop and sold it. And one day the little boy came by, and he saw that sailboat in the window of that pawn shop. He raced in there. He demanded his sailboat back. But the pawn owner said this, pawn shop owner, he said that, I can't just give you this boat because somebody found the boat and sold it to me. You're going to have to pay a price. So the little boy, he had to try to scrape up the money. After a period of time, he came back and scraped up the money that the pawn broker had demanded. And he handed over. Here's the money for my little red sailboat that somebody sold to you. And when he got the little sailboat back, he just put it under his, it was so precious to him because he had spent a lot of time building it and painting it in bright colors. And but the sailboat just, you know, flew away, sailed away. One day the wind got into it. And so he left, he was seen walking away with that sailboat in his arm. He said, little sailboat, you're mine, and you're mine twice. First because I made you. Secondly, I bought you back. So we are God's twice because he what?
He made us.
And then what?
He bought us back.
He bought us back with his blood and his death and his resurrection. So that's the reason why we said we're not our own. We just can't do and run our lives the way we want to. Amen. We got to seek ye first what?
The kingdom
of heaven. Amen. The thing that God is interested in. And all of the things that we seek. Before God, those things will seek us if we would seek God first. Amen. Now, number two, just because we are born again, filled with the Holy Spirit, know the Word, and involved in church does not mean that we are interested in what God is interested in. Everybody can say amen to that?
Amen.
It just doesn't come automatically because you're saved and filled with the Holy Spirit. A whole lot of people are saved. Been filled with the Holy Spirit, but they're not interested. All right? The majority of Christians in the body of Christ will not be interested in God is interested in. Those interested will always be in the what? All right. Number five, I'm going to skip number four. The only people who will succeed in their efforts, this is very heavy. The only people who will succeed in their efforts in the kingdom of God are those interested in what God is interested in. Those who have laid down personal goals and ambitions and made them subservient to God's will and interest. Now, sometimes our people might misunderstand us when we say we need to put God first before our responsibility, routine, and our job, and all of that. But we're not to shun our responsibilities in those areas, but we're to, in all of our ways, what? Acknowledge Him. And let God what? Because if you don't let God run your life, you're not going to run it right. Right? So I think that we need to put God in the forefront. In other words, in the morning, why not spend the first few minutes of your time in what?
Prayer.
In devotion. Meditation. Mm-hmm. Amen. So God can what? Lead you and direct you and equip you or strengthen you or whatever, give you wisdom for things that you do need to what? Perform during that particular day. Care about your responsibilities. Number six is very good. Christians have the responsibility of seeking out and discovering God's interest. It's not going to come automatically. You're just not going to jump up overnight and be interested in souls, being interested in feeling, getting people filled with the Holy Spirit, or responding to people's needs and building them up in the kingdom. That is not going to be an automatic thing that will take place in the believer's life. This is what this statement is saying. God's interest will remain hidden until you seek it out. Setting your affection on things above is a huge, huge issue, but it's a decision that we must make. You can change your interest by a decision of your will. Even I was just thinking yesterday, y'all heard me just today. I was in ministry, it's about maybe 50 to 75 people. These were leaders yesterday, found in Mount Pleasant. And most of them were pastors and missionaries and leaders. And how I got to know them, years ago I went to their church, I mean to the state convention, and they gave me space to do a presentation on nutrition, and I have two books that I have put together on nutrition that I share with hundreds of pastors all over, and it was about, I guess maybe about 20 years ago that I used to come to church every morning and pray from 5 to 7. One morning I was praying, the Lord revealed to me to put in print, put into place all of the teachings that you have done down through the years and put them in a workbook and began to share those teachings with pastors all over the nation. To this day, we've shared them in about 45 different states. Number of people that have bought this book, these books, and shared them with their congregation. Some of the churches are much bigger. I mean, they sometimes are hundreds of thousands. Down in Houston, there's one mission that had about a 2,000 membership. And he said, I used Pastor Bill's material during that period of time. He said, for about 3 to 6 months straight. You know, this was the teaching that I was doing on TV. But the Lord told me that if I would put it in print, I was going through a 30-day fast, and the Lord said that you put this in print and then start going from jurisdiction to jurisdiction all over the nation, telling people about you have enough material that, you know, I have enough material to carry you about 5 minutes in your ministry, salvation teaching, Holy Spirit teaching, growing up spiritually teaching, prosperity teaching, profile of a true disciple teaching. You know, I have a lot of these manuals that I have put out, but in the mornings from about 4, 3 to about 7, that's when God dealt with me and told me what to put in those. And I just obeyed God and did that. And as a result of that, I have hundreds of pastors all over the nation that know me as using my material. And yesterday when I went down to this meeting, I was supposed to be doing something else, and they came to the bishop and said, "We don't have nobody to teach them, the preachers. What are we going to do?" The bishop said, "Well, we'll work out something." So I've asked several pastors to teach, but they refused because they said they weren't prepared. And I told the bishop, I said, "I'll do it." Eager beaver, I guess. "I'll do it." And so I went in there and I talked with them for about 20 minutes. It was really good. But just by obeying God and doing what God says, He said, "No, this has caused my life to be totally different." I remember one time I had to have a $10,000 need answered. That, you know, I had to have $10,000. My life and my family and my everything depended on that. And I went to one meeting and I came back with the $10,000 just from the material. And as a result of that, it has opened all of these doors. I can go almost to any convention that are all over the nation, at state meetings, and I can get most of the material that we have in the hands of lay people, ministers, bishops. There are about 100 bishops that have bought my material. 100 bishops, and some of them got 100, 150 or 200 churches underneath them. And a whole lot of their pastors got the material. That opens a big door, you know, financially, right? You know, you can go there and preach, go there and teach, you can sell books, and, I mean, any worthwhile project you have that you go and present, your credibility will enable them to respond favorably to what you have to offer them. Amen. Somebody said that. Favor, brother, Derek said, favor one day, 1 minute of favor. Dr. Duff Derrick said, 1 minute of favor is worth 1,000 years of labor. 1 minute of favor is worth 1,000 years of labor. So, I really praise God, but it all started in prayer and putting God first. Amen. Being concerned about what my first book was, salvation and the Holy Spirit. And that's something, being interested in what God is interested in. And Sister Pearl, you can understand, it has opened up a whole big gamut in terms of getting people to tap in to other things that they need that would be very profitable to them and profitable to us. All right, amen. Everybody convinced? That we need to be interested in what God is interested in? Right?
Right.
All right, I'm ready to go. Let's say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
We really appreciate y'all coming. Next week, we're going to ask y'all to be prepared. And after that, we give Sister Gaynell and a little more time to get used to how they are doing it. But Sister Gaynell is really, really intelligent, I mean. And Brother George, I believe he can teach you just from your experiences. Everybody's going to have a chance to really, amen, verbalize. Y'all get good at it. I know y'all will. I'm going to have y'all in on Wednesday night. Y'all talk more than the people on Wednesday night. The only one that talk in my class on Wednesday night is Sister Hill and who else?
Sister Fox.
Woo! All right. come with it, I class, whatever y'all can. All right, let's all stand. Father, we thank you for leading and directing us and for motivating us to put you first in all that we say and do. Lord, let your interest be our primary interest. The lost souls of men, those that's not saved, filled with the Holy Spirit. Lord, and those that have been saved and filled with the Holy Spirit, growing up spiritually. Father, this is our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. We give you the praise and the glory. In all of our ways, we will acknowledge you, and you shall direct our path. We give you praise and the glory.